They all acknowledge Dylan as the artist who freed them from the constraints of pop.
Free at last! Free at last! Thank you!
Are you going to Scarborough Fair? Me to one who lives there. For once she was a true love of mine. Tell her to make me a cambric shirt. Parsley, sage, rosemary and thyme. Without no seam nor needlework. And then she'll be a true love of mine. Tell her to find me an acre of land. Parsley, sage, rosemary and thyme.
Today's weatherman is Vic Waters. Morning, Vic.
Good morning, John.
So what about the outlook, the general outlook for the next couple of days?
Well, again, not a great deal of change there.
And then she'll be.
And that's all for Farming Today this morning. We shall be back again, as usual, at 6:30 tomorrow morning.
To everybody to put their empty bottles out on the doorstep where the milkman can see them.
I suppose you've lost millions in the snow.
Yes, we have millions covered in the snow, which won't be recovered until the thaw comes, you see. Over the weekend, we would like all the customers to be on the doorsteps more or less with their money to pay their accounts, because all these delays keep the men out late, and if the roads freeze, then we're in trouble again, you see.
Last show of 62, and we're going to be looking back on this glorious year of number one hits. So let's start the proceedings with the ever-popular Shadows and their blockbuster number one, Wonderful Land. The milkman could still get through when this was number one.
I lived in a cul-de-sac, and the snowplough came and cleared all the roads and dumped all the snow at the end of the cul-de-sac, which was fantastic because it was a huge mountain of snow, but it was still there, the remains of this snow, on my birthday in May.
When I first came to England from Canada, I was struck by how small and grey and compact and cramped everything was after the expansiveness of where I came from. But it was also very exotic. Everything seemed to fit into this very small world. Then there was the winter of 62, which was exactly like Canada.
I was nearly five at the time, and I remember looking through the window and seeing all the snow and not being able to go out in it. Everyone said it was the coldest winter there had ever been.
Missing, believed wiped. The Madhouse on Castle Street, recorded December 30th, 1962 to January 4th, 1963. Broadcast January 12th, 1963 on the BBC. featuring Bob Dylan performing songs Blowing in the Wind and Ballad of the Gliding Swan. I have decided to retire from the world. I shall leave your name with Mrs. Griggs, my landlady, who will notify you when I die. Please arrange for my burial, as I do not wish to trouble the occupants of the house more than is necessary. The ominous letter from the brother whom she had not seen for 14 years brings Martha Tomkins to his boarding house in Castle Street, only to find that Walter has locked himself in his room and is slowly starving to death. But why? Has he committed some crime? Along with his sister, Martha, and the landlady, Mrs. Griggs, the inhabitants of the boarding house, a truck driver, a student, and a guitar-playing hobo, all try and unravel Mr. Tomkins' secret. ...21-year-old folk singer Bob Dylan has been brought over specially from America to take part. Bob Dylan's special kind of haunting music forms an integral part of tonight's strange play.
Half a pound of tuppenny rice, half a pound of treacle, that's the way the money goes, pop goes the weasel. Yeah.
Dear Arena, I read with fascination the recent article in The Telegraph about the madhouse on Castle Street. I'd totally given up hope of finding somebody who even vaguely remembers the play and song sung by Bob Dylan. I remember so well the impact it had on me at the time. There was nothing around like it. Nobody I'd spoke to had seen it, and no record store had heard of a song by Bob Dylan that had the lyrics, "The swan on the river went gliding by." That was all I could remember. I was so glad to hear that it was called The Ballad of the Gliding Swan, but I'm very sorry to hear that you don't have a copy. I'd give my eye teeth to see that play again. Good luck in your search. Yours, David Jones, Painswick.
Shopping days left till Christmas. It's been there since September. Still riding high in the top 10. This one's history. Telstar by the Tornadoes.
News that Telstar was working once more, but I didn't rejoice. On my eighth snowbound day, the news I eagerly await is that the milkman can now get through. Incredible as it seems, we are living less than 20 miles from London, and yet we are still without supplies of milk, bread, toast, and telephone.
Dear Arena, I understand that you're seeking video footage of Dylan's appearance in the play The Madhouse on Castle Street. I must say at the outset that I do not have this. I do, however, have an audio tape. For some years now, a tape has been circulating among collectors that does have Blowing in the Wind and The Ballad of the Gliding Swan. But recently, I've been able to acquire a further tape that has the other two songs as well, Hang Me and The Cuckoo. I should add that as a Dylan collector, I'd like to think of myself as reliable and, where necessary, discreet. If you're interested, please give me a telephone number. Regards, Ian Woodward.
This is The Ballad of the Gliding Swan. Margaret's pillowed wet with tears. My mother's been on it 20 years. Swan on the river goes sliding by. Swan on the river goes sliding by.
You'd think he heard me, even if he didn't. It's a remarkable coincidence.
I gotta say the prize is off the stairs for the time you're riding again.
Mr. McKenna, appalling weather conditions like these must add up to a railway boss's nightmare.
Well, nightmare's perhaps rather a strong word, but undoubtedly things have been extremely difficult the last few days.
How has the region been coping?
Well, not too badly.
The first tape was recorded by a chap called Pete Reed and his brother. Neither Pete Reed nor his brother were Bob Dylan fans. They happened to have the TV on at the time this programme was on, this play was on, liked what they heard, so quickly set about setting up the tape recorder to record Bob Dylan on this TV play, and they got two of the four songs. At that time, very rarely did they actually have a lead that plugged into an audio output. I'm not even sure television had an audio output at that time. And most commonly, they put a microphone in front of the TV speaker.
Music While You Work is played this morning by George Scott Wood and his music.
Second tape is slightly different in the sense that it's not come through a Dylan collector. It's come from someone who was involved in the folk scene at that time. His name is Hans Fried. And Hans, at that time, worked in Collett's record shop in New Oxford Street. Collett's was a fairly left-wing organisation, had a bookshop and a record shop at that time, and Bob Dylan wandered into Collett's and met Hans Fried, and they met. So Hans was aware that he was over here and what he was over here for, and they met on other occasions, I understand, and when the TV play came on, just like Pete Reed, he got out his tape recorder and he stuck it, the microphone in front of the speaker, and he recorded the output, but he just recorded the Bob Dylan bits. But because he was expecting Bob Dylan to be on it, he managed to get four songs rather than two.
Hello again. How many in your class are going into office work? And what about wages? These vary a lot, but here's what the civil service pays. At 16, a clerical assistant gets £5.02.
Where'd you go for your honeymoon?
Where'd you think?
Tell me.
Dagenham.
Oh!
Well, he was wild when he saw the bedroom. What? Well, it was the first time he'd ever seen twin beds.
Oh, dear.
And he turned all sulky.
Did he? Mm.
He said, I thought we was going to have a room to ourselves.
It was still very much a short back and side society. Still very much brown shoes or black shoes. You could just about get a pair of Levi jeans. I mean, that was enormously cool to wear, have a pair of Levi jeans. They were really hard to find. And then there was that whole routine you would go through of sitting in a bath of cold water so that they would shrink to fit you.
I saw Madhouse as a 15-year-old. Something about a swan on the river sticks in my mind. Dylan seemed to be a very articulate young man with a certain attitude, almost arrogant, without being rude. Sorry, I don't have any footage, only the memories prevail. Brian Billett, Bournemouth.
This enables the sweepers to replenish their little trucks with salt without going back to the depots.
This means the English motorist isn't prepared for this sort of weather.
Pitches covered with snow or ice or both, and deserted terraces.
You just had a big success in the United States.
Okay. Oh yeah, we just got back from New York. And Stranger on the Shore, you know that one. You know it.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, that was a lot of the success. You know, it went to number one, and everybody knows me over there.
Yes.
Down in the Grand Canyons of Manhattan, the crowds of early Christmas shoppers are jostling in the streets. In the glittering windows, tinsel and luxury abound.
Currently in the United States, they eat five times per head more than we do in this country. And we have every hope that we shall catch up with them in due course.
There were lots and lots of individual shops. You know, you would find ironmonger's shops. You didn't find McDonald's. The only fast food place would probably be Wimpy's, and they were really looked down on. That's not to say that English food was particularly wonderful at the time. It was just grey.
Martin at goldmiss.co.uk. I was 16 when Madhouse was transmitted. My mother wisely realised from hearing me play Lead Belly records that I would be interested in this character described as a real hobo.
3. Appearing as the hobo folk singer, Bob Dylan is the new figure on the New York folk scene. The song for which he is in British television. Who knows, he may become as regular a visitor to England as his friend and mentor, the great New York folk singer, Pete Seeger.
Big blue sea that separates my home from your home here, and maybe we ought to sing about the sea and all the people that went on it. Lots didn't come back, too. Deep blue sea, baby, deep blue sea. Deep blue sea, baby, deep blue sea. Deep blue sea, baby, deep blue sea. It was Willie what got drowned in the deep blue sea. Oh, some of you know it already, but let's see if everybody can sing it. Try it again.
When I was 18, I started to be Pete Seeger's sister and to try and song lead the way he did, with hundreds of songs that I already knew.
Deep blue sea, baby, deep blue sea.
I came to London because I was asked to perform in a television version of Dark of the Moon, and they needed a female American folk singer who could play the banjo. I remember the red buses. I remember steamed sticky puddings with custard and cream on them and golden syrup. I think I gained about a stone in my first month of being here. I remember warm, friendly people. I remember feeling at home, almost as if I had some kind of genetic memory of my people having been here, because this is where half of my family came from. When I came to this country, I lost track of what was happening in the United States. I never considered living in America once I fell in love with you and McCall. I became a British subject. I virtually stayed over here. Life was endless then. I didn't think of there being any alternative to what I was doing. Life happened to me.
Dear sir, I wish I could say I had a cherished copy of this play. Sadly, I don't. I did, however, see the play, which I remember being a little bizarre. I saw it because in December 1962, my photographer husband, Brian Shule, was deeply interested in folk music. He went to a folk club called The King and Queen and came home raving about a genuinely strange folk singer whose name he couldn't recall. A few days later, we went to the Singers Club run by Ewan McColl, who was the most important figure on the British folk scene, and his young wife, Peggy Seeger. My husband pointed out this young man and later wrote down in his diary the name that he heard, Bob Dylan. Dylan sang wonderfully, but to the obvious displeasure of his host, McColl.
Somebody whispered, Bob Dylan's here. And I seem to remember saying, who is Bob Dylan? I didn't keep up with these things. And he did one song and stepped down, and then the evening went on, because that's the way the evenings were run. As a guest, you had one song from the floor, and he sang from the floor. It was quite a brave thing to do, actually. But then I gather, you know, that he has been pretty brave in his life. We always saw the American-British as interlaced, because some songs from America came over here and almost became folk songs. A lot of them from here went over there and were brought back. I came from a background where there was more or less a purist attitude towards folk music. I learned an awful lot of my songs from visiting folk singers, like Gene Ritchie, Aunt Molly Jackson, Lead Belly came to our house, Woody Guthrie came to our house. I heard the real thing.
I'd just been in Collett's record shop and seen the current issue of Sing Out, which had a picture of this young lad on the front and a couple of his songs inside, and it was interesting stuff. Sing Out was the American folk song magazine. There was an English magazine called Sing, and this much better produced, much more professionally produced magazine, and much bigger, called Sing Out. And its offices were in New York. I mean, it's really specialised stuff. Well, universe anyway, with more archaic principles and values. One where actions and virtues were old style and judgmental things came falling out on their heads. A culture with outlaw women, super thugs, demon lovers and gospel truths. Streets and valleys, rich peaty swamps with landowners and oilmen, Stagalees, Pretty Pollies and John Henrys, an invisible world that towered overhead with walls of gleaming corridors. It was all there and it was all clear, ideal and God-fearing, but you had to go and find it. Didn't come served on a paper plate. Folk music was a reality of a more brilliant dimension. It exceeded all human understanding, and if it called out to you, you could disappear and be sucked into it. I felt right at home in this mythical realm made up not with individuals so much as archetypes, vividly drawn archetypes of humanity, metaphysical in shape, each rugged soul filled with natural knowing and inner wisdom, each demanding a degree of respect. I could believe in the full spectrum of it and sing about it. It was so real, so more true to life than life itself. It was life magnified. Folk music was all I needed to exist.
At the moment, I'm just listening. It's a mono recording, so I'm just checking that both tracks are equally clean,
right,
or equally noisy in this case. So this was just recorded. Was it you that recorded it?
No, it wasn't. And it's just recorded with a microphone in front of a TV speaker.
Yeah.
Tenderly William kissed his wife, her knuckles were white on the kitchen knife. And the swan on the river goes gliding by, the swan on the river goes gliding by. Lady Margaret's pillow is wet with tears. No one has fucked her in 20 years. But the swan on the river goes gliding by, the swan on the river goes gliding by. The doctor gave Sally a sad surprise at the thalidomide baby with no eyes. But the swan on the river goes gliding by, the swan on the river goes gliding by. Little Billy Brown will shake with fright, he has a new uncle every night. But the swan on the river goes gliding by, the swan on the river goes gliding by. My father has cancer, my mother's insane. The girl I'm in love with takes cocaine. But the swan on the river goes gliding by, the swan on the river goes gliding by. When will the swan begin to sing? I am weary of everything. But the swan on the river goes gliding by, the swan on the river goes gliding by. It's fairly traditional ballad form, but the image of the swan on the river, which is the beauty of England, isn't it? And the terrible things that are happening in people's lives. Castle Street meant England, because an Englishman's home is his castle. And the madhouse means what's happening to the inhabitants of this country, or what I felt was happening in the 50s. The play is set in a London boarding house. One of the lodgers, Mr. Tompkins, who one day announces to his landlady that he is retiring from the world, he's going upstairs to his room, and he's going to be there until he dies. And that is the heart of the play, the reactions of people to someone who has renounced the world.
Mrs. Griggs' boarding house, late afternoon. Martha Wright foreground, Lenny Mrs. Griggs background. Pan Mrs. Griggs left to sofa. Close up Martha, reaction. Mrs. Griggs?
Yes, I like your brother. He's gentle. One day, he was just sitting in that chair staring out across the street. Saturday afternoon it was. That's how he'd spend his weekends. He never did go out very much, but lately that's how he'd spend his weekends. That Saturday afternoon he took off his collar and his tie. He never did that. No, always wore his collar and his tie when he was downstairs. Mrs. Griggs, he said in a queer sort of voice, as if he didn't understand what he himself was saying. Mrs. Griggs, I'm going up to my room and I won't come out until I die. And I said, don't be silly. And he said, no, I'm not. I've seen all I want to see of it. And what I haven't seen, I don't want to see. So I'm just going up to my room, Mrs. Griggs, and I'm going to stay there until I die. So I said, nonsense. And he said, Mrs. Griggs, I'll take my meals in my room from now on. Well, it's not the extra work I mind so much, though the stairs are getting steep for me.
It's a play about what civilization does to the tender-hearted. To people who don't have a great deal of violence in them, who don't have any way of expressing themselves artistically, except perhaps the leading character, the young man, who is trying very hard to get out of this, trying to understand what's happened to Tompkins, who's gone upstairs, and trying to understand the world about him.
Close up, Lenny. Lenny.
Call a policeman, call a doctor, a butcher, a baker, a candlestick maker, call a plumber or an undertaker. That's civilization for you. Call somebody to do your dirty work. Who does the dirty work for the people who do the dirty work?
This character of Lenny, for me, was like, he was the person that rumbled everybody. He was the person that made them aware of what it was to have blood in your veins. And he was the person that created trouble, if you like. Playing at Tony Pastor's in 4th Street, I thought, well, this is too good to be true. Because also in the original play, he did play the guitar. And when I heard his songs and I saw him, and he was so young, and tousled-haired, and I thought, if I could just get this on, you know. And I was willing to fight to get Bob Dylan to bring him to England.
The first reading of the play. I hadn't met Bob yet, and we were all sitting around a long table. Bob was handed a script.
It's kind of, I remember rightly, if this was the table, he was sitting just there, just slightly to your left.
Yes, from where you were.
Yeah,
yes,
yeah.
I was on the other side.
That's right. Yes.
When we started to read the first page of Pooky Pryor and Ursula, and we got to Lenny's first speech. And Philip nodded to him. And Bob said, I don't know what I'm doing here. These guys are actors. I can't act. I don't know what I'm doing. So Philip called a coffee break.
Take five. Okay, everyone, take five.
So I left this rehearsal in despair. I lived somewhere along the Circle Line, and I thought, I'll get on the Circle Line and I'll think about this, because we only have a week before we start shooting. What changes can I make to the play?
Also, remember, I was determined at that time that Bob Dylan would be in it.
Yes.
And there's no way I was going to relinquish hold on that. We could have just paid him, and we had egg
That's
on our
true.
Face,
or
etc.
I could have taken all the spoken lines out of the play.
Yes.
But I wasn't prepared to do that. And it occurred to me after four or five stations that there was only one solution, which was to make the character into two. One who did the singing and one who did the talking. So we beat around the bush and found a brilliant actor to play the speaking part, David Warner, and Bob as his friend. So throughout the play...
And they were sharing the room.
Yes. Yeah. They were in the same room. They were side by side like Siamese twins. David Warner would make the speeches and Bob Dylan would sing.
In the early 60s, we had a television for about 10 years, since the coronation, in fact. We used to watch variety shows like the Billy Cotton Band Show, but hardly ever any plays. We certainly wouldn't have watched something like Madhouse on Castle Street.
My parents disapproved of television and thought it would corrupt us kids. But my father finally gave in and said we could save a penny a week of our pocket money to put towards one. By the time we did get a television, they didn't really want us to watch it, and only things on the BBC, anyhow. They really thought that ITV is much too vulgar. Though I don't suppose they would have wanted us to watch something as strange as Madhouse on Castle Street, even though it was on the BBC.
Mrs. Griggs' boarding house, interior, late afternoon. Mrs. Griggs.
It's getting dark already. I think I'll close these curtains. There's not much light in London when winter comes, and it's dark at tea time. When I was a girl, we lived in Devon.
Martha.
Mrs. Griggs, you were telling me about my brother.
Mrs. Griggs hesitates. Bobby sings, Hang Me, Oh Hang Me. Mrs. Griggs.
Bobby, please.
Lenny.
What's the matter with it?
Mrs. Griggs.
It's a very pretty song, dear, but I'm trying to talk to Mr. Tompkins' sister.
Lenny.
Not pretty, Mrs. Griggs. Beautiful. It's all about death.
It was very cold. Everywhere was cold. Everywhere was cold. It was bloody freezing. But I was in a group, called them groups in those days, called the Thameside Four. And we ran a club at the King and Queen. It's Goode Street, just by the Middlesex Hospital. And I look out into the audience and I see this sing out cover of sitting in front of me. So I finished a couple of songs, left someone to sing, and walked over to him and said, "You're Bob Dylan." And he looked at me and I said, "I saw you." And he's, "No, you know that." And I said, "I saw your picture on the front of Sing Out. Do you want to sing a song?" And he said, "Ask me later." So we carried on with the evening, about 20 minutes, and he just looked at me from the audience and went, nodded. So I called him up, and he had a guitar with him. And he, what else is going on? And I told him about the various other clubs. I said, there's the Singers Club in Soho Square, that's a Saturday night club. I said, there's the Troubadour in Earl's Court, and that's a late night club, starts about 10:30. And my wife, Dorothy, said, I'll put the kettle on, make a fire, Mart. So I said, OK. We had this useless piano and a samurai sword, and we had to keep warm. So I went and dragged a bit of the piano, got the sword out. And as I was about to swing the first one, he stood in front of me and said, "You can't do that, that's a musical instrument." I said, "It's a piece of shit." I started chopping it, and I felt this shadow at my shoulder and looked around. He said, "Can I have a go?" So we built a fire.
So, did Dylan stay with you?
No, he was staying in a hotel down in the West End. I don't remember which one.
Bob was staying at the Mayfair Hotel in London, and he was having problems at that time with his smoking habit, and the management of the hotel sort of lent on his manager and Grossman and indeed Bob, and asked him if he would refrain from that kind of smoking. And so I suggested to him, why don't you, would you like to come and stay in my house, and you can do what you like there? And he said, yeah, you know, because he knew my wife. And anyway, he came there and he brought all his stuff, and we put him in a room, in his own room, and he was happy there. And anyway, the following morning, I got up to have a pee and everything, and I heard this music coming up, guitar sounds, and I wandered along the landing, and there at the bottom of the landing, because I had a little baby then, and were two Spanish au pairs. Anyway, there he was, at the top of the stairs, singing, anyway, such and such, etc. And these two lovely little girls were like two little robins or starlings looking up at him. And I he didn't know I was behind him. He was kind of like there. And I just applauded, you know, and I just said, oh, Bob, would you sing that on the opening and closing of the production? And this was before the actual song became an international hit.
It will never be possible to make to turn them back into a pristine recording.
Absolutely not.
You know, it's the character that you're looking for, and
absolutely.
I think they're full of that.
And at the moment, it may change, but at the moment they're the only tangible evidence we have of his appearance here, in a sense.
Isn't
Lenny's youth in the boarding house, and disturbed youth. He has not settled for anything. He has not got a job. He's half educated, wants to educate himself some more, but he's critical of everyone else and everything else.
I suppose the thing about youth, of course, why they are so appealing on the one hand and disturbing on another, is that they are unafraid. And it's this fearlessness that we admire in youth.
Dear Arena people, I read in yesterday's Sunday Telegraph that you're looking for a copy of The Madhouse and Castle Street. Alas, I don't have a copy, but I did work on the play. We had 3 days in the studio in which to rehearse it and then record it in the final 3 hours of the last day. The recording proceeded slowly, but at the end of the allotted time, we had not completed it. So 1 hour's overrun was agreed, but not a moment more.
They hadn't seen anything quite like it before. Well, I say never, but almost hardly ever seen anything like The Madhouse and Castle Street.
I was very puzzled. I didn't really make anything of it. I think I was probably more excited that my mate was in it than anything else. I think we were on the floor. And the play was just going along, and they were just doing it, and then suddenly it wasn't happening anymore, and people were running around saying, what's it? They pulled the plugs.
Savile directed the play from the studio floor rather than the gallery, a technique that's commonplace now but was not in use then on multi-camera dramas. This annoyed the technical operations manager, who accused him of wasting time.
He hadn't come down. Mr. Tompkins hadn't come down yet.
That's right. And Mr. Tompkins hadn't come down, even more important that he didn't come down. And I needed another 25 minutes to do this.
I don't think you've ever heard Bobby sing. He sings very pretty songs, and he sings them quietly. What do you think, Bernard? That's a good idea. Art is my distraction. I shall not want. This is the ballad of the gliding swan.
This is the ballad of the gliding swan. Every way I'm just wiping over your head. With the night swan, just riding by, riding by. Margaret's
pillow is wet with tears. My mother's been on it 20 years. On the river goes blind, blind. On the river goes blind, blind. To think he heard me, even if he didn't, it's a remarkable coincidence.
What happened was, it was over a weekend, and it was on the 30th of December. So half the nation was drunk. And the head of engineering was on a fishing holiday up in Scotland somewhere. The order came down, the technical manager, and whatever he says, you must obey. So we're thinking, my God, what are we going to do? You know, fantastic. The technical manager was heading for his pension and certainly didn't want to blot his copybook. So, in the middle of shooting, he gets onto the telephone and he goes, hello? Tell us, Siri. Oh, thank you so much. You can go home now. Thank you. Yes, we won't be requiring you anymore. Bye-bye. Because the actors came up to me and said, well, Philip, what are you going to do? You know, and I said, go home.
That boy's mind must be a chamber of horrors, chamber of horrors, chamber of horrors, chamber of horrors.
It's a fun house with mirrors.
The plugs were pulled, all activity ceased. It needs to be stressed that the crew were quite keen to carry on, but engineering management wanted to show who was boss. The final irony was that it had been snowing hard all day, and by 2300 hours, all public transport had packed up, and many roads were impassable, so nearly everyone spent the night at Television Centre, where the argument raged all night long.
My memory of it was the decision to stop was taken, and it was a final decision. They weren't going to remount it until Stuart Burge spent the whole of New Year's weekend buttonholing everyone in the BBC and got their permission to remount the thing and get all the actors back.
I had this wonderful generic producer, Stuart Burge, who was absolute godsend for a director like me.
It was done. I know, I went home and locked myself in the room and went to Bedford until Stuart called on the Monday morning and said, we're going to finish it.
The wind was so cold that the sea froze on the Essex coast. In places, temperatures went down to 19 degrees. It was in this blizzard that three people died battling against the snow, and two more were suffocated in a snow.
Nobody in England had a manager. Nobody in Britain had a manager. It's unheard of. Agents were the devil. Al Grossman, he was just about the first of the great enabling managers. No, love him or hate him. That's what he was. He did everything for his artists always did. Whenever Albert came to town with one of his charges, he'd bring him round the folk clubs because that's what Albert knew.
Are you going to Scarborough Fair? Parsley, sage, rosemary and thyme. Remember me to one who lives there. For once she was a true love of mine.
Well, he went away and then came back, yeah. And in that time, he wrote Girl from the North Country, because he was always asked me to sing Scarborough Fair, and always asked me, Scarborough Fair, sing Scarborough Fair. He came down and said, written a song. And he started to sing the song, and it was Girl from the North Country, which he'd based on Scarborough Fair.
I played a part in the Madhouse on Castle Street story. At the end of 62, about a year before I managed the Rolling Stones, I'd set myself up as a press agent. I was 18 years old, and I scoured the Melody Maker and the other weekly musical rags looking for gigs. A journalist told me about this Bob Dylan being flown in from America to appear in a BBC drama. Nobody outside the folk scene knew who he was, and I found out that Bob and his manager were rooming at the Cumberland Hotel overlooking Marble Arch. I made a point of bumping into the manager, Albert Grossman, in the lobby of the hotel. It was Grossman's singular devotion that impressed me. To be sitting in a small hotel room giving all his time to just one artist. They were both very happy. They acted like they knew something we didn't yet know. I hustled myself press-repping Dylan for a week for a fiver, and I scored a big piece in a now-forgotten magazine called Scene.
I remember he said to me, you know, Philip, I'd like to have known you a couple of years ago. He said, you know what, you should give up all this, he didn't use the word bourgeois, but he used something similar, all this correct way of living. Why don't you come on the road with me? And I thought, God, if only I was brave enough to do that.
Of course, one didn't know that Bob Dylan was going to be Bob Dylan or anything like that. I met him many years later, and he reeled off the names of all the people, all the actors, and Philip Savile. He said, how's Philip? Have you seen Georgina? How's Ian? How's James? How's Maureen? I could not believe that the young man that I remember then could possibly have remembered the name of anybody involved in the play. The first thing he said to me, because the part was split into two, he said, hey, you played me.
And I just wish that we had the film, that we could actually see what the film was all about. And it would be very, very interesting if we could have had the film today.
kissed his wife, then he opened her head with a butcher knife. And the swan on the river went gliding by, the swan on the river went gliding by. Lady Margaret's pillow was wet with tears, nobody's been on it in 20 years. And the swan on the river goes gliding by, the swan on the river goes gliding by. I got a sad surprise, the doctor said, a 20-pound baby without any head. And the swan on the river went looking by, the swan on the river went gliding by. Well, the preacher was yelling and selling his hope, the price was too high, so I said no. Nope. And the swan on the river went laughing by, the swan on the river went gliding by. When will the swan begin to sing? We're so weary of everything. The swan on the river goes gliding by, the swan on the river goes